Okay. Let me start. We can see the Schrödinger equation written here. Psi is a vector in a Hilbert space or wave function. For simplicity, we choose h equals to 1 and denote partial derivative of psi with respect to time by dot. In a Hilbert space, we have a scalar product written here. And usually, we assume that the wave function is normalized to unity. We consider a general case when the Hamiltonian depends on time. For simplicity, let us consider the finite dimensional Hilbert space. First, let us consider the orthonormal basis denoted by EK. K runs from 1 to n. And we assume that it is time independent. We have the usual expression for the scalar product. And in this case, the Hamiltonian is a Hermitian n times n matrix. The Schrödinger equation can be written in components in this way. And this is the usual approach to the Schrödinger equation. Let us now consider time-dependent basis, which is assumed also orthonormal basis in the Hilbert space. It can be decomposed with respect to the old basis, which is time-independent. Here I denote it by SKL, some unitary matrix. Then in the new basis, the expression, the Schrödinger equation can be written in this form, where psi prime are components with respect to time-dependent basis, and h prime is the Hamiltonian in new basis. It can be expressed, its components can be expressed through components of the this matrix in this form. And we immediately see that the Hamiltonian transforms like a connection. If we introduce the matrix denoted by AT, which is simply I times the Hamiltonian matrix, then it is the element of SUN algebra. And we can identify it with a local SUN connection, one form, or gauge field. Then the Schrödinger equation can be written as a parallel transport of a vector in the associated fiber bundle. So geometric interpretation of quantum mechanics may be given as follows. We have a principal fiber bundle where R is the base manifold. We have some projection. And the structure group is SUN. It is trivial fiber bundle because the base manifold is the Euclidean space, real time. Wave function is local section of the associated fiber bundle with the base manifold R, some projection. Hilbert space is the typical fiber. The structure group is SUN, and this associated fiber bundle is associated to the principal fiber bundle P. This very trivial, in some sense observation allows us to easily prove the adiabatic theorem. Let us assume that Hamiltonian depends on some parameter mu. Mu equals epsilon times t. T runs from 0 to 1 over epsilon. We assume that it is differentiable function. Let us consider some unitary matrix S, which diagonalizes the Hamiltonian. HD is assumed to be diagonal. This is the definition of the unitary matrix. We consider now the case of non-degenerate energy levels. Then we have two equivalent Cauchy problems written here. This problem is written with respect to constant basis in the Hilbert space, and this problem is written with respect to non-constant basis in the Hilbert space. For psi prime and h prime, we have this Cauchy problem, and it can be easily solved. And this is a solution in the primed, in the moving frame. This is a well time-ordered exponent of the integral of the Hamiltonian. This power series converges uniformly in a ball of arbitrary radius epsilon. So the limit epsilon goes to zero is well defined. Now suppose that at the initial moment the vector was in some eigenstate with the energy E. Then in the adiabatic limit epsilon goes to zero, this term can be dropped. And we see that this initial state acquires only the phase. And this is the well-known adiabatic theorem. If the Hamiltonian depends on some parameter mu, which equals to epsilon times t, and if the initial state is an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, that then in the adiabatic approximation, in the adiabatic limit, it remains to be the eigenstate corresponding to the same energy level during the evolution. This is very simple proof. Now let us consider the same problem for Hamiltonian, which is not diagonal. We assume that phi is the eigenstate of the Hamiltonian corresponding to the energy level E. Then, according to the adiabatic theorem, it evolves during the evolution. It may acquire only a phase, theta. Substituting this expression into the Schrödinger equation, we have ordinary differential equation for capital theta, and it can be easily solved formally. In the usual treatment of the adiabatic theorem, we say that the first integral can be chosen in such a way that it equals zero. The proof usually goes in this form. We substitute a new vector in the Hilbert space, which differs by a phase beta. Then if we require the scalar product of chi with chi dot equals to zero, we have ordinary differential equation for beta, which has a solution, which always have a solution when t belongs to a real line. But this is not true if t belongs to a circle, because when we return to the same point, then the phase in general will not differ to 2 pi n, where n is a natural number. So this gauge condition can be chosen only for the whole line, not on a circle. And in fact, this is the Berry phase. physically, it means if time belongs to a circle, it means that we have a time machine. So it is not considered here. And Berry said the following. I'm sorry. Let the Hamiltonian depend on a point of some manifold, M. If we choose a coordinate system, lambda, on this manifold, then the Hamiltonian depends on a set of parameters. Now we consider that point moves on this manifold, and there is a curve lambda of t. Then the phase can be written as an integral. The second integral is the usual dynamical phase, and the first integral may be written in this form, where ak is given by the scalar product of phi with partial derivative of phi. From the normalization condition, we easily prove that AK is real, and so the Berry phase is also real. Now we consider a closed curve on a manifold M. Then the Berry phase is given by a contour integral of AK, and it has very simple geometric interpretation. We have a principal fiber bundle. M is the base manifold. There is some projection, and U1 is the structure group. Vector of the Hilbert space is a local cross-section of the associated fiber bundle. Under vertical automorphisms, automorphism, which is written here, A is some differentiable function. We have the usual transformation for the components of the local connection form. The exponent of the Berry phase is an element of the holonomic group. And if the manifold is simply connected, then using Stokes' theorem, we can express it through surface integral, where S is some smooth surface having lambda as a boundary. And FKL are components of the curvature-2 form, or gauge field strength. This example was already considered. If we consider spin 1/2 particle in a magnetic field, then I want to stress here only one point because of the lack of time. Our parameter runs over whole three-dimensional Euclidean space because magnetic field is arbitrary and defined everywhere and homogeneous. I skip this example. This is the expression for the Berry phase. It is proportional to the solid angle at which this contour is seen from the origin of coordinate system. The principal fiber bundle is trivial here because the base manifold is Euclidean space. And in this example, we clearly see that Berry phase is not a topological phase. It is a purely geometrical notion because topology here is trivial. In the non-abelian case, let us consider energy level E, which is degenerate. By phi A, we denote orthonormal basis, orthonormalized eigenfunctions. If we introduce the field AKAB, one can easily prove that it is an element of SUN algebra, and under vertical isomorphism, it transforms as a component of... this is the consequence of the Schrödinger equation. And this is the solution for the unitary matrix U. The first factor is the Wilczek-Z matrix. The second factor is the usual dynamical phase, which is exactly the same as in the abelian case. And the Wilczek-Z unitary matrix is given by the ordered exponent. And if we consider closed loop, closed curve, then it defines an element of the holonomy group. Here, the principal fiber bundle is, has M as a base manifold and SUR as a structure group. We have associated fiber bundle with M as a base manifold, the tensor product of Hilbert spaces as a typical fiber, SUR as the structure group, and it is associated to the principal fiber bundle P. a manifold M can be trivial or not. It depends on the problem. And it's, it means that Wilczek-Z unitary matrix is a geometrical rather than topological effect, because in some cases M may be may have non-trivial topology, but it also may have trivial topology. It doesn't matter. The Aharonov, let us consider now the Aharonov Bohm effect. We have Schrödinger equation. Here are the usual notations. We introduce by minimal substitution interaction with electromagnetic field. Here is the correspondent Schrödinger equation. This is a well-known scheme, and the phase can be written as a contour integral of the zero component of electromagnetic potential. Geometric interpretation here is follows. We consider the Schrödinger equation, we solve the Schrödinger equation in the four-dimensional Euclidean space, because T belongs to real line and X is three-dimensional Euclidean space. So the principal fiber bundle here is trivial. Euclidean space times U1. We have associated fiber bundle. It is also trivial. It's direct product. We have psi is a local section. And the Aharonov-Bohm phase defines an element of the holonomy group. I would like to note here the following. The, an element of the holonomy group is invariant, is an invariant object. It is invariant with respect to gauge transformations. It depends on the connection and on the path. You may cut out here whatever you, you like. One axis, two axes, how many, whatever you like. It doesn't matter. An element of the holonomy group remains the same. It doesn't depend on the topology. This is the magnetic Aharonov-Bohm effect. So the same arguments are applied here. So conclusion. The Berry and Aharonov-Bohm phases can differ from zero even for trivial topology. They arise as a consequence of non-trivial connections on principal fiber bundles. Therefore, they should be considered as geometrical rather than topological effects. It may be non-zero. Usually, non-trivial topology implies non-trivial geometry. But non-trivial geometry may exist even for trivial topology. And therefore, these phases can exist even for trivial topological problems. And I want to stress that the elements of holonomy groups are gauge invariant objects. Okay, thank you.
When I first drafted my phase paper in 1983, I gave it the title Topological Phase
Factor. No, geometric.
1983, and I drafted my paper in 1983.
Ah, in...
My colleague John Hannay said, you mustn't call it topological, it's geometrical.
Yes.
This was obvious. So this point has been known for many
years. I agree.
Yeah. beginning of transforming to a moving frame, which is the eigenbasis of the instantaneous Hamiltonian, that's something which you can carry much, much farther than you have done. And indeed, I did that in 1987 in a very systematic way, because if you do it once, you can do it again and again and again. And each time you do it, you get a contribution of the geometric phase, and this way you get all the corrections of any order to the geometric phase. So the zero order is the dynamical, the first, the minus one order is the dynamical, the next is geometric, and you get all the corrections by this procedure which I call adiabatic renormalization. The series that you then get can be studied in detail. It must diverge. If it didn't diverge, the adiabatic theorem would be exact, and nothing would ever happen in the world. There would never be any transitions. But the fact that the world changes under the action of time-dependent Hamiltonians is reflected in the divergence of the series that you get when you repeatedly apply the transformation of which you looked at just the first iteration. So just two comments.
This is the paper that is linked to the book
at the end of it. It's published.
It is reprinted. It's reprinted. Yeah.
Okay. I used this moving frame only once here. But for me, it's enough. For me, it's enough. This series converges uniformly in a ball of arbitrary radius. So the adiabatic limit is defined. I didn't say about it. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much.